Hello, I'm Dr. John Iskander. Welcome to CDC's Beyond the Data. I'm here today with Dr. Lisa Richardson, Director of CDC's Division of Cancer Prevention and Control and a practicing oncologist. Welcome, Dr. Richardson.
Thanks for having me, John.
In past Grand Round sessions, we've heard about screening and other preventive measures to try to decrease the population burden of cancer. At today's session, we learned about genetics and its role, specifically in certain types of cancers. What do we know about the burden of genetically determined cancers?
We've known for a very long time that cancers run in families, as you probably know. And recently, we've learned that there are certain gene mutations that can increase the risk for breast and ovarian cancer, as well as colorectal cancer, which we learned about today.
So what are some of the terms that people may hear for those specific types of either genes or syndromes that go with breast and ovarian and colorectal cancers that have these genetic factors?
Well, for breast and ovarian cancer, the genes that are defective are the breast cancer 1 and breast cancer 2 genes. They lead to an elevated risk of breast cancer and account for about 25% of all breast cancers diagnosed with a genetic syndrome. For colon cancer, it's Lynch syndrome, which is also a defect in a gene that causes DNA not to be repaired, and that occurs in about 3 to 5% of all colon cancers.
Okay. So there are clues to these that clinicians can be aware of, often in family history. Mm-hmm. What are some of the interventions on an either an individual or population level that can benefit people with these family or genetic risk factors?
Well, the first thing for the doctor or other healthcare provider to do is to take a complete family history to determine the risk. The histories of people who come to you and that you're trying to figure out if they have a genetic mutation are cancers occurring at early ages in family members. For breast cancer, it is bilateral breast cancer, cancer before the age of 40. For colorectal cancer, the same. The average age of colon cancer being found is about 60. People less than 50, less than 40 would, you know, be tested for a higher risk to see if they have a higher risk or a gene mutation.
Okay, so that's how we identify people who are mm-hmm. at risk. There are ways to then enhance our ability to screen them mm-hmm. or detect issues early, and right. What are some of the options there?
So for our breast and ovarian cancer, the main options are surgical, where we would recommend that women have mastectomies or remove both breasts, as well as have their ovaries and fallopian tubes removed. This actually removes the tissue that would become cancerous, and therefore the cancer would not develop. For colorectal cancer, it's quite different with Lynch syndrome. We would start screening as early as 25. The usual recommendation is to start at 50.
So again, we're tailoring mm-hmm. these type of screening or intervention recommendations to,
yes.
to people's genetic and
yes.
family risk. And again, I think we should stress that some of the particularly surgical mm-hmm. things are considered options at this
yes.
point rather than
yes.
Recommendations.
So for breast and ovarian cancer as well, there are medical medicines that we can use as well to lower the risk of developing those cancers.
All right.
Yes.
So I think one of the insights from today's session was that we are now crossing the chasm, if you will, mm-hmm. from doing this on an individual level
right.
to looking at this from a public health perspective. Mm-hmm. And we heard from Deb Duquette from the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services. What are some of the things that CDC is helping states do to really implement a public health approach to genetic cancer?
So we have funded several states, including Michigan, that presented today, to try to get a handle on what the true prevalence is and what the true risk is in the population. In Michigan in particular, they've worked with primary care providers to actually raise their awareness and screen women and men for these genetic syndromes. And some of the data that she presented today showed that they have had some success with increased numbers of referrals for screening, as well as increased testing for these gene mutations as well. Secondarily, we've been using our cancer surveillance data, the cancer registries, to identify what might be the prevalence in the population of people who need to be screened for a high risk of familial cancer or hereditary cancers.
Yes, so again, using a lot of the classic public health approaches of surveillance, educational interventions.
Yes.
I believe they're also working on some policy interventions as well.
Yes.
So you did mention screening of men. Could you just remind us what familial cancer syndromes men might be at risk for, and what some of the family history markers for that might be?
Right. So for men, the main one is colorectal cancer. Men and women are affected at similar rates with the gene mutations for Lynch syndrome. In particular, one signal, a very strong signal in families, is male breast cancer. The BRCA2 mutation leads to more male breast cancer, and those men definitely need to be evaluated, as well as their family members need to know that there is a man in the family with breast cancer.
Okay. So we heard today from Lindsay Avner, who runs a not-for-profit that works on educating both patients and clinicians about hereditarily determined cancers. She describes herself as a cancer previvor.
Mm-hmm.
For people in our audience who are hearing that term for the first time, what does that mean?
Well, I believe a previvor, the way the term was used by Lindsay, are people who know that they have mutations in these genes, who've taken actions to prevent the cancer. And so in Lindsay's case, she had a bilateral mastectomy to prevent the cancer from ever happening. And I think that's what they mean when they say previvor, never develop cancer.
And I believe she was one of really the first people to opt for this treatment,
for the mastectomies.
Treatment alternative.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we collaborated on this session with the Office of Public Health Genomics at CDC, and Dr. Muin Khoury gave a talk where he put this in the broader context of some new initiatives, particularly precision medicine.
Mm-hmm.
So can you give us a little flavor? How is what we're talking about today, how is that an example of precision medicine?
So my understanding of precision medicine is that we're trying to, as a research community, we know of some gene mutations, but some unknown. So what we're trying to do is look at cancers and families to determine where those gene mutations are and determine what the significance is of those mutations. The secondary part of precision medicine is looking at actual cancers to determine therapy. But the one we're most interested in today is the one where we look at the gene profile of a person to see if we can determine risk for developing cancer in the future.
Okay. So let's come back to that more specific issue of precision medicine right now to conclude. So what are our goals as a public health community for the near and maybe less near term future in terms of detecting these on a population level? What does that future look like to you?
So as an oncologist, I'm very excited about the new precision medicine initiative, us discovering more and more what causes cancer so that we can intervene. But the one thing I'd like for us to remember is that the family history tool is the very first gene mutation tool that we've developed and that we can use. And regardless of what those results are, When you have testing done, if you have a strong family history, it means something. On a population level, to go deeper into the genome, to look for signals for genes that might be new to cause cancer. As I said earlier, only about BRCA1 accounts for 25% or so of hereditary breast cancers. So there's a lot of things that we don't know, even about the hereditary cancers, that we're able to test for. And that's what I think the new initiative will be helpful with.
Okay. And you mentioned the family history tool, mm-hmm. and there is a link in the presentation, mm-hmm. and yes. we'll make sure that that's available to people. Thank you very much for joining us today, Dr. Richardson.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Please join us next time for Beyond the Data.